the big, brave heart freedom. Ready? One, two, three.
Freedom!
All right. Thank you very much. I think they heard us in the bar back there with that one. Now, how many of you think that endorsing or vouching for Hillary Clinton is a good strategy for libertarians?
No!
Also, are you trying to tell me there's a difference between being inclusive and being suicidal? Okay, good. So, right now we are at a critical time for the freedom movement, especially for the Libertarian Party. We have a lot of important issues in front of us, and there's a big debate, as you heard earlier in the vice chair debate tonight, about being inclusive. We all obviously want to grow the party, we want to grow the base, we want to increase freedom in our lifetimes. The goal of the Libertarian Party should be to put itself out of business because we don't need it anymore. So, in that goal, there are a lot of people who are doing some incredible work to bring people into the party. Now, being inclusive, being united, bringing people together is not about la-la libertarianism. It's not all sunshine and rainbows. This is a real fight that we have before us, taking down government. And make no mistake, we are dealing with the most evil people on the planet. If there is such a thing as evil, it is manifest in the institution of government today. Make no mistake. So, in that effort, there's someone here tonight who I want to recognize because he's doing some great work growing the party, growing the movement, and bringing people in an inclusive, inviting way, and yet he has faced some big challenges in that. So this is someone who I've worked with in, six, seven years ago, back when I was doing Adam versus the Man as a three-hour nightly live podcast from our basement in Virginia, and he's always been someone whose voice I respected, someone who really embodies what this message is all about. And what he's doing right now in organizing the Mises Caucus is providing a critical avenue for people to feel comfortable participating in the Libertarian Party. So without further ado, I would like to yield a few minutes of my time tonight to my friend and the chair of the Mises Caucus. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Mike Heise.
Thank you, Adam. Yeah, I've been friends with Adam here for about, what he said, like 7 years. And I can honestly say that I've never met somebody who has really made their life about this message the way that Adam has. Adam really truly is a soldier for this message. And his heart is 100% in it. So I just want to thank you for everything that you've done. So this was an unexpected thing for me, and I got this opportunity on very short notice, and the whole speech thing is new to me, so I was kind of scrambling to put together what to say, you know. So I guess I set out to answer the question for any of you who don't know, what is the Mises Caucus? What are we doing? So, but before I can answer that question, I have to ask a question of all of you, and I want you all to think about it, and that is, why are we here? Why are we here? Why are we in the Liberty Movement? Why are we in the Libertarian Party? What do we hope to achieve? And how do we hope to achieve it? Now, if you ask me that question, the answer to that question is, we're at war. We are at war. It's not a war that we started. It's a war that is being put on us. There's a war on reality. There is a war for the truth, reality, and over ideas. This war is being waged on us by a power elite in the government, in banking, and a fascist crossover between the two, because remember, fascism is the merger of corporate and state power. And these powers have actually altered the masses' view on what is reality and their interaction with reality. These so-called public servants, these controllers, these harvesters of productivity, are the external gatekeepers of human productivity. This might sound radical, and it is, but it's the truth. It's the truth. Some of you have been in this war with me for a long time. We fought on many different battlefields. We fought in the battlefields of the Gary Johnson campaign. We fought in the battlefields of the Ron Paul campaigns. We stood together when the American people rejected war with Syria in 2014. We filmed each other being arrested. We bullhorned together. We protested. We collected signatures. We rallied, and we've grown together. And no matter what infringements on natural rights come down, no matter how appalled we get if every bomb dropped, or how high the debt goes, we are still here, and we still have our fists up, because we are the vanguard of liberty. As soldiers in this war, there is a bond that has been formed between all of us that only people who are brave enough to step on the battlefield and see the battlefield can understand. And this is exactly what the Mises Caucus is. The Mises Caucus is a band of brothers that has been formed largely in and around the Ron Paul campaigns and the Austrian school. And that focuses on, that is putting aside our differences to focus on the core principles of liberty. True free markets, peace, property rights, the non-aggression principle, decentralization, freedom of self-determination. Many of these soldiers are libertarians that are not in the Libertarian Party. Why? Why is that? I have set out to answer that question, and I've talked to many of these people. Most of them really do want a healthy, strong, successful, and viable Libertarian Party. They're rooting for us. They're rooting for us. However, and unfortunately, many of them look to the National Party and see a party that does not live up to its promise or principle and seems to be more focused on political gains than implementing ideas. You know, Mises has a great quote that I really love that goes, "To defeat aggressors is not enough to make peace durable. The main thing is to discard the ideology that generates war." Libertarianism is a philosophy, first and foremost, and it's a set of principles, not a political party. The political party is to implement and spread that philosophy. The nature of our war is psychological, not political. We are tasked with actually changing people's minds. We are fighting against the belief and faith in arbitrary authority, the idea that complete and total strangers have any authority over us. In reality, the only authority to us is our God, our conscience, and the truth. Take your pick. You know, we have the greatest and most powerful message in the world, the message of individual liberty. And the only way that we can believe that that message is actually viable is a love, or at least a faith in humanity. Indeed, our ultimate goal is to free the potential of humankind, of humanity, from the force of the state. And despite the state, that potential is still greatly realized. We see it all the time in the cryptocurrency community, like Nexus, who is going to be shooting up an array of satellites to beam decentralized internet to the planet. And not just internet, but banking services through the blockchain, and this can start a free market revolution the likes of humankind has never seen. So let's come together and build a Libertarian Party that the majority of libertarians can be motivated to join and proud to represent. Let's raise an army and wage peace through ideas. Thank you, Adam, for the opportunity. I really appreciate it. Thank you for everything you've done and your friendship over the past almost decade. And, Mike's yours now. It's yours anyway.
Does anybody here enjoy the divisiveness and bickering in politics?
No.
Is it better when it's libertarians fighting amongst libertarians? Sam Konkin wrote the book on agorism, came up with the term agorism, right, of free market, civil disobedience, and withdrawing your material support from the state. Very important strategy, although it's not what's going to end the state, it's how you get to live a freer life today. Now, Sam Konkin liked to tell a joke. He said there are two definitions of libertarian. One, anybody who calls themselves a libertarian. Two, anybody who agrees with me on absolutely everything. Alright, good. We got a point. You guys get the point here. Now, I'm going to talk to you tonight as libertarians. I'm not going to give a campaign speech or give some rah-rah speech about, the freedom, virtues, and how we achieve a free society by waking people up. Because you know what? I want to talk to you directly about the direction of this movement and what we have before us and how we face the challenge of the state and how we can actually take it down in a practical way. Because, as you may have noticed from the little bus we've got parked outside, I'm running for president on the platform of dissolving the entire federal government in a peaceful, orderly, responsible way. The first thing I'm going to do is resign. I'm not running to be president so much as the custodian of the federal government, to go in as a bankruptcy agent for the purpose of carrying out an orderly bankruptcy proceeding and dissolution of the institutions. And I only say that as a lead into my next point, which is that I don't think there is anything more anti-freedom you can say than, I want to be president of the United States of America. How can you in good conscience say that and still call yourself a libertarian? Now, the difference in strategy that this platform represents is fundamental to our movement, because for too long we have been playing their game. When we put someone up as a candidate for president, what we are saying is that we should have a president, that we should all be forced into this one-size-fits-all solution, that we can have someone who knows better for the rest of us. And obviously, some of us would take issue with those assertions. So, the difference in this strategy is so critically important, because we can't even agree amongst ourselves on what the definition of libertarianism is, right? We have these endless debates, and for too long, because we have played their game, because we have assumed that there is one answer to the question, we have failed to recognize that there are numerous answers, that everybody has a right and freedom to determine for themselves the directions of their own lives. When we play their game and say, yes, we all have to be forced to this one-size-fits, nobody except the profiteers of government solution, we fail to recognize that which unites us in freedom. If you're a conservative who doesn't want to force their views on anyone, you're a libertarian. If you're a liberal who doesn't want to force your views on anyone, you're a libertarian. Dare I go further? Yes, if you're a socialist who doesn't want to force your views on anyone, you're a libertarian. If you're a communist who doesn't want to force your views on anyone, you're a libertarian. And when we embrace this message that embraces the differences among all of us and the right of individuals and communities to engage in that self-determination, that is how we unite people in freedom. We know that in our message, there is a fundamental element of human nature that we all want to be free. We are all human beings with an individual will, with a desire to have that will realized and respected in the world. That is what unites us. Not politics. Not forcing everybody together in a one-size-fits-all solution. When we can push power down locally, that is what can take this party from being a debate club to the political force that it needs to be to win. You guys want to win? Let's stop playing their game. When we say that we want a free society, we have to acknowledge that if someone wants to bring people together on their private property in a voluntary manner, they might want a community where guns aren't allowed. You might want to ban guns on your own private property. Now, just as an aside here, the correct libertarian position is not pro-gun, it's pro-private property. I don't need a right to own guns under the Second Amendment, because I have a right to own property, and no one else has a right to tell me what I can and cannot do with my property, or what kind of property I can and cannot own. So, if people want to come together at the community level and say, hey, we want a community where guns aren't welcome, well, we've all come together to form this with our own private property, we would respect that, would we not?
Yes.
I mean, I wouldn't want to live there, but hey, let them have their experiment, right? Similarly, maybe somebody wants a community where drugs aren't allowed. Okay, I'm not going to go to any of your parties, but hey, if you want that in your community, you're welcome to be organized that way. You want a community where gays aren't allowed? Oh my gosh. Well, hey, it works fine well until one of your kids comes out that way, right? But we want to respect people to be able to come together in their own communities to determine how they're going to be organized. The most important part about libertarianism is not being a central planner. We respect the rights of individuals and communities to come together on their own terms and organize how they see fit in the best interest of their own happiness. Now, I heard something earlier in the vice chair debate that I thought was really beautiful, and it was about listening to people. How many people in this room have run for office? All right, awesome. Talking to voters. Have you ever heard a voter say, you know, I really need a politician with a more philosophically consistent worldview? I don't think it's ever happened in the history of American politics. And that's the selling point to us, right? Because that's how we come to this. That's how we come to freedom, is that we ask these hard questions and we want absolute decisive answers. Now, I was making a major mistake in my approach to activism. I've been a full-time activist now for about 11 years, starting with the Iraq Veterans Against the War. And by the way, when I got back from Iraq in 2004, the first time I could afford it, I became a lifetime member of the Libertarian Party, and I encourage all of you to do the same as soon as you can. So, and by the way, shout out to Preston and Steve Sheets for becoming lifetime members of the Pennsylvania. So, what I've done over 11 years of activism was a lot of listening. Not always because I wanted to. I was an angry veteran. I wanted to shout. I wanted to be angry. I wanted to be mad. And this is one thing that I think is a really important shift for our movement. We don't need to be inflammatory. We don't need to piss people off. We don't need to push people away. If we really want to say, hey, we are the adults in the room, and it's time for the adults to take charge and for the old parties to get out of town, then we have to be calm, confident, and reassuring. We don't have to be inflammatory. We don't have to piss people off. We don't have to push people away. When we are calm, confident, and reassuring, that is when people will give us the authority that we are asking for to take the system down. So, in that listening, like I said, I've never heard anyone say, well, we need a politician with a philosophically consistent worldview. What do people want? It's not a 400-page book by Rothbard. People want basic human needs met. Now, there's a big divide in our movement, and it's a real bullshit, false dichotomy between principle and pragmatism. Are you guys familiar with this debate? That's like saying, gee, I want to get in shape. Should I eat right or should I exercise? Should I be principled or pragmatic in approaching the goal of a free society? Because principle is pragmatic. That's the point of having principles. You do unprincipled things, you get unpragmatic results. And if you compromise your principle and say something as anti-freedom as, I want to be president of the United States of America, well, guess what? The result result is not very practical. Compare the impact of Dr. Ron Paul Sr. to that of Bob Barr, Gary Johnson, and Bill Weld. What resonates with people? What connects? Principle is pragmatic. That's the point. There is no reason to compromise principle in order to be pragmatic. And someone who is telling you, give up your principle, give an inch, just a little bit, just put support someone who wants to be president. We can have a better messenger. We can have a better message. No, the minute you have compromised your principle by one iota, even the average voter who's not paying attention will smell that. And you will turn them off and drive them away, and you will invoke the part of them that says, well, what's pragmatic? Let's go with the lesser evil of the Democrats and Republicans. But when we embrace localization instead, not only do we end the bickering, we end the splintering, we end this false division within our movement, but we get to take charge in a bigger world. Now, some of us, as libertarians, are really opposed and inherently in our souls to the idea of telling other people what to do. That doesn't mean we should be afraid of taking leadership. I always like to put audiences on the spot. So here's my question for you tonight. How many of you designed the cut of the shirt that you're wearing right now? Yeah, nobody, right? Yeah, some, there's always some smartass in the back like, no, I'm a fashion major. I design these clothes. No. My point should be clear here, because if I was giving a speech on fashion and design, I could now look down my nose at all of you and say, what a bunch of sheeple. If we believe in specialization of labor, we should also exercise specialization of leadership. Most Americans don't pay attention to politics, and they engage in a kind of very, very rational ignorance. They don't want anything to do with government, and rightly so. So how do we take charge? How do we provide that leadership to the American people? Give them exactly what they want. When government is localized down to the community level, you want this in your community, that in your community, you can have it. People in San Francisco shouldn't be writing laws for people in San Antonio. No kidding. But when we say, look, we're just going to take government apart one layer at a time from the top down until it gets to the point where you have, at most, a voluntary system of government in your community, guess what? Everybody gets what they want. The things you like about government, you can keep. You've heard this somewhere before, right? If you like your government, you can keep it. This is the everybody gets what they want strategy. That is what we have the potential to do with this message. Now, before I wrap up, I just got to say a big shout out to Stephen, to Carolyn, to Drew, and to everybody who made this event happen tonight. So please give it up for them. Now, this strategy of localization, there's a lot of thought that's gone into it. This has come from 11 years of activism, of me banging my head against the wall, of doing things the hard way, of trying to get the average American to read a 400-page book, right? It's not going to happen. Taking leadership, providing value for others means we have the potential in this, and we need to embrace it to make things easy for everyone. I'm not running for president so much as I'm turning the American presidential campaign into a referendum on whether or not the federal government should be allowed to exist at all. When we can do that, when we can give the American people the opportunity to actually vote nobody for president, we can put forth the message that is as principled as possible, as pragmatic as possible, and speaks to the core of humanity. So I know there are going to be a lot of questions about this. We don't have time to get into them in this venue. We have two great speakers with Dale and Ken coming up after me. But thanks to Steve, we're going to have the room on the far side of this conference area available tonight. I invite you all to join me outside, in that room. When the other speakers are wrapped up, I'll be in here listening to them as well. So, remember, when we stop bickering, when we see past the petty divisiveness, when we embrace principle and pragmatism as equal, commensurate, and values that are cooperative, that are synergistic, then we can unite people around the message of freedom. Thank you very much.